Welcome to this tutorial on Kiwi 3D and isogeometric analysis. Within this tutorial, we're going to learn how to set up an analysis model for isogeometric analysis using shell elements. To do so, I've created a surface in Rhino and referenced it into Grasshopper. And to create shell elements out of it, you just want to check out the element category of the Kiwi library. There in the middle, we find the shell element. Just connect the surface here on the very bottom. And then below, we have mechanical properties we can set. Second input here is the material. So we need a material definition within Kiwi. In the element category on the very top, we have different ways to set the material. I just use this default material component here for the beginning. And to select different materials, just select the native Grasshopper valueless component. So this guy here is living in the very first category. If I connect it to type, this drop-down menu here is popping up. Can select from different preset materials to use. Okay. I have just added a material component, so let's check out what else do we need. There is the thickness input, so you could change that one if you want to, set with 0.1 for the beginning. And then we have the refinement here following up next, and I think that one requires a little bit of additional information here. So it's quite important to consider the refinement within isogeometric analysis. Because we are using the NURBS description for the simulation directly, we need to make sure that we have actually enough degrees of freedom to provide, for example, deformations. So when we select here a definition of refinement, so we're going to go for the surface refinement here because we have a 2D geometry object, what we provide here is an increase in the polynomial degree for both of the surface directions, as well as a subdivision of the knot vector of your NURBS. I don't want to go into it in too much detail. I'm just going to tell you, if we increase polynomial degree and subdivision for your knot vector here, it's basically increasing the number of contour points for your surface. So for that surface, if I say here points on, let's see the contour points, I have basically four contour points in the corners. So if I want to like deflect the surface in set direction, I will not be able with this kind of parametrizations. But if I increase the number of contour points for the surface, I will be. And how to increase this number of contour points is via the setup of a refinement. And we are good for the moment here. Okay, what else do we need? We need to make sure to define supports, and to define supports I will just add points in Rhino, and for the moment I just add four points each corner of the surface, and I will reference them into Rhino. So I select those four points, there we go. And then if you check out the supports category here, we have support points, reference them in, and at the very top we can connect the list of points here. You can change the constraints for translations, rotations, and so on. But let's leave that one for now. Okay, we have generated support informations for the surface. Let's add a load. I'm just going to go for the curve load for the moment and add that one here at the bottom. So where is the curve load located? To give this information, I will basically just draw a line here in onto the surface and then reference this line into Grasshopper. Select that one, connect it. If you go through the input values here, you can choose from different types of loads. You can choose load direction, value, and then you have additional parameters here on the bottom. I don't want to dig into for the moment. The load I've created here is fine for the moment. Okay. We have shell element, supports, and the loads. Let's assemble all of it in a analysis model. So I go for the analysis model here on the very top. And let's check out the input here. So on the very top, we have analysis, type of analysis. This is the one thing missing here for the moment. If you check out the first category here on the left, you have different tasks to be able to run with Kiwi. And we are going with the linear analysis here for the moment. It requires a name of analysis. So I just say here Kiwi tutorial shell, for example. Connect that one to name. And then we have output settings here, which might be interesting to look at. So for that one, we again use value list. And if you connect it to output settings, we get this those checkboxes here. And you can, like here, select whether you will have stresses in the output later on. So if your model is getting quite big, it might be useful to do not check for stresses. So the entire guide just runs faster. Okay, so we have created an analysis task. So let's connect it to the model at the very top. Then second follows all structure elements here. We just have the shell for the moment. Supports following up. And you can already see, okay, something has changed. If you look at the corner points where we have defined supports, you see those support symbols. Let's add a load. And if I do so, we can also see okay, line load in like kind of the middle of this shell. Okay, this is the analysis model. To see like results, I'm gonna add a solver here. And the solver basically requires an already assembled model to be connected to. Do so, and then I'm generally using the toggle component. Set that one to true and connect it to run so the analysis is running in the background. And if your model is relatively small and you can like check for live updates, you just say suppress shell window to be a little bit faster. Okay, model is solved. We want to see deflections. To do so, check for results category on the top that we have deformed model. Just connect the solved model here onto, and you can already see, okay, something has happened. If you zoom in a little bit, we can see some deflections quite small for the beginning. That would mean let's increase, for example, the load. Okay, we have an initial value here of 10. So I'm just going to go for 20 for the moment. So the load has increased, and as well has the deflection. What we can also do is that we scale the deflection a little bit. If you check here for the deform model, we have load cases here, and then we can also so scale deflections at this bottom input. So just scale them with 5. And now we can see quite precisely, okay, the shell has deformed, and it's just like supported at the corner points. Okay, but let's have a look at the kind of result we are getting here. So if you check for the output here, the geometry, we get a surface out as an output. And we could now, for example, say, let's see the control points of this deformed surface. And we're going to see the control points here by calling this graspable component surface points. If we connect the surface here, I see like all the control points. And now this information, like the number of increased of those control points, they are directly related to the kind of refinement I'm defining here at the beginning. So Let's see if we, for example, change the polynomial degree here. So we just change it to 4. We would expect to get an even higher number of control points to have more freedom to actually deflect correctly, let's say that way. So I'm going to add 4 and 4. And as you can see, we have increased polynomial degree in both directions. The number has just increased. Just delete this one, you get the old number of control points. Okay, so this is where we can see the effect of refinement directly. And the other thing we just realize here, because we are using isogeometric analysis, we are still within the NURBS description. So the geometry coming out here is still of NURBS type. Okay, so let's say we want to see a little bit more detailed of what's going on inside shell. So I just preview off all those guys here. Just say, do not show geometry here. So I'm basically just seeing the deformed geometry. I'm going to kill that one. And I want to see some results within the shell. So I just use this color plot component for 2D elements. And here, it requires a model input at the very beginning. And if I connect the deformed model, it will return like or plot the colors onto the deformed configuration. Again, value this component to choose settings of what I can see here. And if I change here for set displacement, it allows me to actually have a plot of the displacements here in set direction onto the shell. And I can also choose, because I've selected stresses here, can choose from, for example, von Mises stress plot within the shell. So you can choose from different parts here, set a color domain, change the color domain here with a right click. For example, if you prefer that one, this is the color plot output for surfaces. Okay, I preview off that one because I want to show some additional stuff. The other thing we can look at are the support forces. So support forces, I'm going to plot them onto the initial model. Select the initial model, connect it onto. I can see I have a straight set support force and four corners. But if you look at the results, at the vectors, we have basically two vectors, two per two, which are equal, which is making sense here because the line load here has a little bit of an offset from the middle. Okay, so this is the support force display here. So additionally, I want to show you a little bit more tweaks onto the input. So let's say we're going to change this the support locations, for example. So you're going to, for example, move that point here onto the surface. I immediately see the impact. So if I move it over here, not much has changed, but I now move it into the middle. I can directly see the impact. So the deflection reduces and this corner point here pops up. What is important here to remember, whenever Kiwi is realizing that a defined support is connected to one of the structural elements, it will actually display the support symbol here. Meaning if you drag it away from one of the structural elements, like I do now, it will not be considered as a support, and as a consequence, if like huge deflection here in that corner point. So this is kind of a good way to double check visually whether we have modeled it correctly, because you can imagine this is like a tolerance issue. If you do not model that point like precisely onto your surface, it will never be considered as a support here. Okay, but let's say we're gonna add an additional surface element here. So what I'm gonna do, I just draw a additional surface, example, in a style like this. So those two geometry objects, they share this edge here, along where they both meet. And this is important because if I reference now the second surface into Grasshopper, I just basically just add it to the structure shell element here. What I will see is it's immediately connecting. And if I just add additional points here to hold the surface in those corners, I'm going to select those two and reference them. You can see how we can build up a model of out of two surfaces. If I preview off, you can see a little bit more precisely what's happening here at the seam where both of them met. And it looks like if we have a continuous behavior between two patches, this is a quite powerful tool here. And the other thing I want to make you aware of are those white dots here, where both of the surfaces meet. So again, because we have just referenced two surfaces, and they are basically individual objects within Rhino, I need to know once I assemble the model here, where the different individual patches are connected with each other. So what is going on here? In the background, Kiwi is running intersection checks for different patches to identify where we have a common edge. And whenever there is a shared edge discovered, so to say, found, Kiwi will display those connecting points. So they are kind of a welding seam, meaning whenever you do not see those edges, for example, if I move that surface here a little bit, I can't see a connection here. So the white dots are missing, and like the second surface is just not considered within analysis. So let us just do this one. I just increased the load a little bit, working now on both patches. And as you can see, in that area where the line is not connected to one of the structure elements, there's no line load created, basically. If you move this guy here a little bit to the middle, and we see increasing deflection between on that side, on that patch as well. One last thing I want to show you. Kiwi is also able to consider trimmed patches. And to just show you, I'm gonna like cut a little bit of that surface here. So we are creating a trimming edge here, saying we want to trim that part of the surface. And as soon as we update the model, you can see, okay, information is just followed within Kiwi. Because we have cut that support here way, we have just increased the deflections again. Okay, so far on simple shell models with Kiwi 3D. If you want to check out additional informations, if you want to get reading on the theory behind, I recommend you to check our website, which is kiwi3d.com, and which is here below this video in the description. Yeah, and thank you for watching.